We'll call the Budget and Finance Committee meeting of Tuesday, November 29th, 2011, to order, and we are going down to item number six first. That's the quarterly budget amendment.
In your packet, you actually have a copy of the amendments for the first quarter, July through September 2011. It's actually two pages. The first one is the cover memo, and the second one actually lists the different items. And the items that have arisen, it starts out with the 84 lumber property. There was some damage to the tall mast arm at Del Rio Magnolia traffic signal. There's a chemical storage facility, which was begun in 2011 and didn't get finished until 2010. There's the half cost of a shared siren with the city of Brentwood, and that siren is at Moore's Lane and Franklin Road.
Is that a tornado siren?
Yeah, a tornado siren, yes.
Okay. Sorry, I need clarification on all these things.
There's also a transfer to the solid waste fund for these two replacement transfer trailers that are listed. There also is the legal judgment, and this is the compensatory damages and the back wages. And the last thing I mentioned here is the board has given the city administrator the ability to do some administrative reallocations. And what we'd like to do, and I believe it may already have taken place, the actual transfer, this is actually just to say that for the budget, to allow us to basically reallocate those monies from the planning department to the engineering department. So with your recommendation to the board, this would actually reduce the general fund balance by $2,961,858. And I guess that's what we would recommend to staff, is that this be recommended to the board.
Let me just add, the big expenditure obviously here is the purchase of the former 84 lumber property, which will be our consolidated public works facility. We have provided in the other direction the board gave earlier the ability to debt finance that at some point if we so choose. So that will be a decision we've reserved the rights for ourselves to do. So that could help us if we want to fill the reserve back up. We can do that, but we don't have to. We may decide we want to stay with the cash purchase as part of the financing plan overall for that project, but we have reserved that ability to do that should we so choose down the line if we get into some additional debt financing that relates to that project in particular, that acquisition can be recaptured through that as well. So that's still an option you have open to you.
Well, do we want to recommend this to the board?
One of the reasons, if I may, that we wanted to bring these amendments to you quarterly is if we go ahead and adopt these, then they start reflecting on the monthly and the quarterly reports that you have. You know, if we don't go ahead and include these, then it looks like we're in either better shape or worse shape than we really are. So I think to do these on a timely basis would really be helpful as you look at the reports.
And that's what we have decided to do. Mm-hmm.
Is bring them, and that is good, I think, discipline from a staff standpoint, is that we look at these quarterly and clean up the items that need to be cleaned up that you couldn't have anticipated in the budget process or that have changed in the course of business. So I think it's a good discipline to keep ourselves in, and I would recommend we keep moving forward with these.
Okay, I recommend that we move this forward to the full board.
That's where I second it, correct?
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, no. And we can also go into item seven, which is the investment policy update, and there are kind of some
cleanup changes. Mm-hmm. If I may, Madam Chairman, seven and eight really go together. On the next item, number eight, we're going to ask you to award a contract to an investment advisor for the portion of money that we have to invest on a regular basis that is non-pension money. The pension money is taken care of, and we have a separate mechanism for doing that. But because of the circumstances, we're really looking for someone professionally to manage this money on a regular basis. To help accommodate that, we want to go ahead and update the investment policy to the most current version of the GFOA recommended, the government finance officers recommended policy. Now, we have adapted it in many ways to the city of Franklin. You'll see references in there. I must admit, we still caught a couple of typos that need to be changed. But what we'd like to do is to get this cleaned up before we bring an investment advisor on board where she can start fresh with the cleanest policies. And I might point out, too, that on the back page, the list of attachments, one of the major things that we want this firm to help us do is to develop all of these appendices, the procedures manual for all the different types of investments that they are, and how we should handle diversification and verification of the stability of the banks and the agencies that we invest in.
And really, a lot of this is just, I don't want to say they're minor changes, but they're just to put us in conformance with the what the
they are. For example,
GFOA.
For example, GFOA now refers to total return instead of just yield. So when you're looking at an investment, you're looking at the total return, both the appreciation or depreciation in price, plus the yield that you're getting. It's a more all-encompassing term, and there's a lot of nomenclature changes like that in there. There are a couple of other things. For example, in the GFOA policy, Canadian bonds were allowed. We've struck that out now because they're not allowed by the state anymore. So we've just clean again. It's a cleanup. It's what we call a minor text change, but we would recommend that you send this to the board for approval.
We're just going to look at 7 and then 8, or 8 is a little different, I guess.
I would do them separately.
Yeah, okay. You need to do them each year.
Okay. I saw one very minor thing on that page 2. When we change that to policies, you need to take out the A.
Did you
get that too?
That was the typo.
Oh, did you? Okay,
I've
great.
Got a couple of others in there too.
Okay, well,
that's
the only one I caught. It just happened to be at the first, but I guess the other question that I had was on page 11 of this, where they, in the middle of that, it says if the credit rating of security is subsequently downgraded, is that the situation that we had before, or did we have some concern that they were going to be, some of the want to say the bonds?
Well, if you remember, our friendly U.S. government was downgraded
by
one of the
agencies. No, I understand that, but no, but this was of a security. I thought that maybe one of the banks that we were dealing with, or one of the financial institutions we were dealing with.
Well, they're addressed in here as well,
but
I think it primarily is looking at any kind of paper that you own and how it's rated.
Okay.
The key components here that talks about the primary objectives of safety or security of what we invest in being a key, the liquidity that we have, the cash flow and liquidity that we need to respond to our responsibilities overall, and then just getting the best return that we can within that context. And so that's really what this provides a guideline for, and again complies with what the overall standards are from the general Government Financial Officers Association. So I think collectively this puts us in the right place, gives us good guidance, keeps us in line with the recommended standards that are out there.
And this has generally been our policy since 2004. We're just making the updates.
So then this item then would be to forward this on to the Board of Mayor and Alderman on number 7.
Mm-hmm.
I so move.
Second. I have a question. But it says in here it's not affecting the way there are no investments affected on just the way we would currently are.
It does say that if we have an investment that's not in compliance, you don't have to rush out and sell it.
Okay,
but you just don't renew it.
All right.
As the appropriate opportunity comes available, you get into compliance
right.
If you have something that was outside
compliance.
What your policy
allows you the
you're transitioning the policy.
Yeah.
And so you're not going to force yourself to do something.
To take a loss.
That is a good time, right?
Obviously, if you could sell something at par, you go ahead and liquidate it right away.
Mm-hmm.
But it prevents you from being put in an awkward spot where you're forced to take a loss.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering about. How does that, okay. That's about the only thing I had. I wanted to know. Okay.
Is there any other comments? Then we're ready to vote. All in favor of sending this to the full board, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay, that motion passes. Then we're ready to go back to the front.
Going back to number eight, you have an extensive memo from Brian Wilcox, who led the team that did the research on this.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I came to you approximately a year and a half ago and essentially said, the world has changed. You know, if you can't trust U.S. Treasuries, who do you trust? It's very difficult for us now to be able to pinpoint the safety and security of some of these agencies. After the turmoil that we went through, particularly in 2008, but some of the ripple effects have gone on. So perhaps you think maybe the safe thing to do then is to just bring the money in and invest it casually in your local banks that you know and trust. The problem is those banks, you don't know if they're safe either, but we pretty much do.
Yeah.
But they don't want our money. And they evidence that every week when we bid out our money, and they really don't want our money. So we're forced into a position that we've never been in before. And that is, we have a considerable amount of money that can only be invested short term, rates are extremely low, and we don't know where to put it. And the trend that we've seen over the last 3 or 4 years, at least since the meltdown, has been a lot of cities that have much larger and more talented staffs than we do going to professional advisors to do this. So we asked you to let's give it a try. We went through the process, we hired a consultant to put together the RFP and so on, and we've selected someone, and this is the contract that we're bringing to you now. There were 10 bidders in this. All of them were highly qualified, I might add. Some of them were a little better positioned than others because they dealt either primarily or entirely with local governments. They're very familiar with the needs of local governments because we have such a short window. We have so much of our money is needed back within 8 or 9 months of the time we receive it, and we have a maximum of 4 years that we can go out under normal circumstances that the state allows us to have maturities out to 4 years, and under special circumstances, 5. Really ties our hands as far as what we can do. And the goal that we have by bringing these people on is not necessarily to squeeze out a little more yield, although we would like to certainly do that and expect to do that under certain circumstances, but to at least get the same yield that we would have done with more safety, with more comfort, less volatility, less risk. So we're trying to look at the point where when rates do come back, we'll have someone who can help us earn a little extra, but for right now, protect the assets that we have.
Okay.
And we highly recommend this firm.
Got a couple questions. It says that, you know, it's $25,000 for 3 years, right?
Per year.
For 3 years. So what if there's an issue with the firm during the 3 years, then would our contract be able to be voided? Or
it says later in the contract that either party can withdraw on 30-day notice.
That, but it was, mm-hmm. You know, even if it's, we don't have to give up like a major reason or anything, if we just felt it wasn't.
We don't. If it's not working, mm-hmm. I think they'll be as eager as we are to make a change on that.
Okay. The other thing is, since they scored the highest score, you know, we've got volatile companies out there, as we're talking about. So have we changed the criteria, or exactly what's the criteria for the scoring of these companies? Have we changed that criteria at all, or is it basically made the same?
This is a new position for us, though.
Yeah, this is a new position.
A new connection, I should say.
But I would
we still have those criteria that we go out. with our companies.
We do, but I would offer to you that depending on the panel that is selected to rate the companies, mm-hmm. I mean, you have high graders and you have low graders.
Yeah.
If you get a bunch of low graders in a group, I mean, the winner may have a high of 62 instead of 92.
Right.
So it varies depending on the product, depending on the team that you have, depending on the quality of the bidders. I wouldn't go by just the numbers alone. It's the relative numbers that count.
So, but some of the criteria would certainly address the volatility of that company or the stability of that company.
It's really the qualifications of this group or the folks that are working for you, and especially their experience working in
municipal government.
Setting like we're asking them to help us in. So I think that's the kind of thing we look at. Do they have the qualifications, background to meet our needs? What's their experience? Because we can't anticipate exactly what's going to come our way a year or two from now, but we can look at their overall experience and anticipate how they might be able to respond to it. And then we evaluate how well they do. There's a 30-day out if it's not working, and it's really with cause or without cause. We can terminate or they can terminate.
Okay. So. Good. That's a good safety net.
And I think we look at the benefit on an ongoing basis, that it's delivering what we hoped it would, and try to evaluate, are we getting our money's worth?
Right. Okay.
And we're actually recommending the flat fee contract. The offer, they also offered to do it for 8 basis points. Mm. And that's virtually the same amount of money, but as our amounts invested grow, the flat fee really works in our benefit, so we're recommending that we do the contract in that manner.
Is that another question?
Yeah, how often in a calendar year will they make recommendations? I don't know how this works.
Almost daily.
Really?
Ongoing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, they will provide us every month, and it says in the contract,
like
with cash flow estimations and what we should do. They'll tell us what's maturing and rolling over and needs to be invested. Do you have any banks locally that are bidding higher on CDs that we can compare and juxtapose the treasuries versus agencies versus CDs, etc. So we expect to have contact. And again, that's part of the reason for this contract. We just can't devote the amount of time daily to really do justice to the amount of money that we're investing.
Yeah.
Does it worry us at all that they're all the way in Portland? I mean, I know we live in the cyber age, but...
Well, you had a choice between Armonk, New York, which was as far east as you can get on Long Island.
That's IBM.
Or Austin, Texas, or Portland.
I don't know, IBM. Let's play those again.
What about some other comments about this? And this would be to recommend awarding the contract.
Yes.
They're pretty much hands-on. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's what we need. We have to have something hands-on. Like Brandy asked, you know, how often, I mean, we know that there'll be, you know, for that fee, there'll be.
And you probably saw in the contract, they plan to come at least annually and maybe twice a year and make a presentation to this committee as to how they're doing.
I recommend for approval.
So there's a motion to recommend to the board for approval and a second.
Yes, ma'am.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. That passes. So now are we ready to get back?
Do we jump back up top?
Yeah, I think we need to start. Okay, let's
we need to jump back up to item 2 for chair and vice chair.
I had a forgetful mind today. I went ahead to go back home and pick up my stuff from this evening.
I guess we're on item 2, election for the chair.
I move that we accept by acclamation Ann Peterson as chairman and Beth Berger as vice chairman.
I second that.
Darn it, I wasn't even here.
That's
we could have done it without her.
That's why we waited until you got
here. Let's see, a motion for acclamation, does that require, I mean, it is, we have seconded it.
Yeah, it's moved and seconded. I would just vote on that motion.
Who seconded it?
Brandy did.
My second thing I did.
I'm not seconding myself.
I guess the motion then is, all in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. So it passes.
See, your return, Allison, it's just an excuse for you not showing.
Okay, then the next item would be the approval of the September 27th committee minutes.
Move for approval.
Had to go find them.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion there? All in favor of approving the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay, now then, we have the audit presentation from Crossland Assessments.
No problem.
How are you?
Good. There's that 133 pages, right?
There is one coming that's...
133, I counted.
Conference.
Surely I'm not paying that out. I haven't seen it written, I'm like, oh. Did you see my printer?
I swear, this also is a catering.
One more. Here you go.
So we got another set?
We sure.
For Linda?
Yeah, I have one.
This is new paper, I'm accustomed to it.
Oh. Wait a minute.
Okay, so...
This is our guide, right?
One of these is for the conference center.
Yeah, that's what I figured out.
Comfortable for the presentation.
Yeah.
We have our, this is our initial report for you in terms of the annual audit report for fiscal year 2011. We do have a new audit firm that we brought on board, Crossland Associates. We have a three-year contract with them, so this is their first time through with us. It's always good to refresh and have a different set of eyes look at what you're doing from time to time. That's what we've done here. I will compliment them. This is the earliest we've ever had this presentation, so they moved through the audit process, I think, thoroughly but quickly to bring this to us and to bring this to you. Tonight, we'd like to really just give you an initial overview of what's been presented. We know you just got this, but highlight it and maybe walk you through some key points that the auditors would like to bring to your attention. And we'll do what we've done in the past, which is provide an opportunity for Q&A from you and other members of the board between now, and we could bring them back in January for follow-up questions, et cetera, if you'd like. We would ask that at the end of this presentation today, that we do move this to the board to at least accept the audit. That allows us to go ahead and submit this to the Government Financial Officers Association for review as well. So that doesn't mean we end any dialogue or discussion on it, but it does allow us to submit it by the end of the calendar year, which would be very good. So I'm not sure who's going to...
I will.
So I'll go ahead and get us started.
Good afternoon. I'm Dan Miller with the firm.
Great name.
The Dan Miller. I'm an audit principal with the firm. I served as first principal on both the city and conference center engagement. This is Dale Crossland. He's our managing principal, and he served as the concurring reviewer on both engagements. You should have, if we got them all distributed correctly, four documents. There's two for the city and two for the conference center. Two of them have pictures on the front, which are the audit results, and then two are the actual financial statements. I'll start with the report on the city of Franklin, the one with the lamppost on the front. On page one of this document, it's an introductory letter saying that a direct line of communication between our firm and the Finance Committee is really essential to an effective audit. So again, we appreciate the opportunity to meet with you today and discuss the results of our audit. Our letter also expresses our appreciation for the hard work and courtesy extended to us by all of the city management during the audit, especially this first year. They did a great job in getting us through the learning curve. On page two, we have audited the city's financial statements and have drafted our unqualified opinion. That opinion states that the financials are fairly presented in all material respects in accordance with U.S. generally accepted accounting principles. The state of Tennessee does have oversight responsibility for our audit, and the Comptroller of the Treasury approved our audit engagement through their standard contract process. We will file our audit report along with the financial statements with the Comptroller's office, and it will be posted to their website. We confirm that we're independent accountants with respect to the city within the requirements of both the AICPA and also under government auditing standards. The engagement personnel on the city's audit are listed there at the bottom of page two. Again, first principal Dan Miller, Del Crossland, concurring reviewer. It's also important to note Rich Lockwood, who is the technical reviewer. Rich is a member of the GFOA and performs reviews of CAFRs for cities all over the country. And so in that capacity, he reviewed the city's CAFR from the GFOA perspective.
And a CAFR is a?
Comprehensive Annual Financial Report.
Thanks, Eric.
You're welcome.
On page three, our responsibility under U.S. auditing standards is to obtain reasonable but not absolute assurance regarding the fair presentation of the financial statements. In planning and performing our audit, we consider and test certain elements of internal control in order to design our auditing procedures, but not for the purpose of expressing an opinion on internal control. So there's no separate opinion on internal control. On page four, the significant accounting estimates that are reflected in the city's 2011 financial statements include property taxes receivable and the related deferred revenue, allowance for doubtful receivables, useful lives and valuation of capital assets. Obviously, this is a very significant estimate as the majority or the largest asset on the city's financials are the capital assets. Fair value of derivative financial instruments, and then the appropriateness of the assumptions used to calculate pension and OPEB obligations. We have reviewed and audited all of those estimates. We believe that they're reasonable and appropriate and comprehensive under accounting principles. At the bottom of page four, during the course of the audit, there were three adjustments posted to the financial statements. I'm going to skip through these briefly now. We're going to talk about these again when we get to the findings section of the CAFR. But briefly, the street acceptances at year end were reduced by $9.2 million. That reduced infrastructure assets and also capital contributions. To record the net pension asset increased assets by $2 million. And then to adjust grants receivable, reduced grants receivable and also deferred grant revenue by $77,000. On page five, all of the audit adjustments that were identified have been recorded in the financials. There are no unrecorded journal entries. The significant accounting policies used by the city are described in note one to the financial statements. Again, we have reviewed those accounting policies and note that they are appropriate and comprehensive under accounting principles. We had no discussions with management regarding alternative accounting treatments. And we did not note any instances in which management consulted with another accounting firm regarding financial statement matters during the audit. We had no disagreements with management during the course of our work. On page six, there were not any matters that we discussed with management that we considered to be conditions for our retention as the external auditors. We encountered no significant difficulties in performing the work and did not identify any fraudulent or illegal acts during our audit. We are not aware of any other documents that will contain the audited financial statements. And then at the bottom of the page, we have read all of the information within the city's CAFR, which includes the basic financial statements, the statistical section, management's discussion and analysis, as well as the transmittal letter. We note that there are no material inconsistencies or misstatements of fact within all that information. On page 7, the areas of our audit emphasis where we focus the majority of our work. I'll run through some of these briefly. Cash and investments, which of course has been a topic already discussed today. We did confirm all of the significant balances with third parties. For capital assets, again, a very significant area, we tested a sample of the current year additions. Additions were fairly significant this year, about $36.5 million in capital asset additions. Most, as you would expect, would relate to construction and progress and infrastructure. Street additions and related street construction totaled about $21 million for the year. For receivables, we tested property tax receivables for the budget year 2012, along with the related deferred revenue. Under classification of net assets, the GFOA is very particular and is looking very closely at the classification of net assets under GASB Statement 34. And there were some comments in their review of the prior year CAFR that we followed up on and looked very heavily at classification of net assets this year. Under debt, we tested the issuance of $15 million in new debt as well as $17 million in refunding bonds. We also tested the presentation and disclosure requirements for debt. Under revenues, we tested property tax revenues for 2011. We confirmed state shared revenues of $8.7 million, and then also analyzed the local sales tax remittances from the state. Sales taxes were actually up 8% this year, which is a positive sign. Consideration of the conference center activities, of course, we'll discuss when we get to those financial statements. Consideration of the pension and OPEB assets. Those amounts are determined by the city's actuary, and we received and reviewed that actuary report, looked at all of the assumptions and methods, and noted that they were appropriate and have been consistently applied. Implementation of GASB 54. This was a new statement where the GASB wanted some additional information. They're really looking for more information on the level of restrictions of fund balance. And so whereas in previous years, fund balance was primarily reported in two categories, reserved and unreserved, now under 54, there are five categories. So again, GASB's wanting a little more information about the level of restrictions on spending of fund balance.
You're saying there's five levels?
Yes, yes. And I'll point those out when we get to the financial statements.
That was my question.
Yeah.
It's on page 15. We'll talk about that.
All right.
But city management did an excellent job of reading that standard, implementing it, and getting it within the financial statements. And those are the required communications. Are there any questions on those?
I have a question. When you talk about, on page 4, when you talk about the fair value derivative financial instruments.
Yes.
Are you just talking about the contrast between two different parties, or the contrast between variables there, or what are you talking about?
Yeah, there are two. The city has two interest rate swaps,
right,
to swap variable rates for fixed rates. And so those have a fair value that's determined primarily by a third party in this case. And those are recorded within the financial statements at fair value.
Okay. Like the fair value of stock of the an ownership of a certificate, okay, of stock. If you own General Motors, mm-hmm, it has a fair value. It's the same principle.
All right. Good. Okay.
But probably for the general public, that these derivatives have nothing to do with
you're right.
derivatives that...
Well, they are a derivative. They are one of the derivatives.
Well, but they're not...
I didn't understand.
The same type of derivative, right?
That variable rate. Variable rate, whatever they are derivatives, which is that bad word.
Well, I think most, everybody else is thinking about the subprime loan derivatives.
That's right.
It has nothing to do with that.
These are interest rate swap derivatives, much different.
Yeah, okay. I just want to make sure I understood that. Okay.
I mean, look at that. Selfie, is that next?
Yes.
Yes.
I'll start with the, I'll try to hit most of the highlights or changes from the prior year CAFR. I'll start with the independent auditor's report, which is under the financial section. It's actually pages 1 and 2. Again, our independent auditor's report is unqualified as drafted. The report describes the sections within the CAFR that we give an opinion on and those sections that we don't give an opinion on. Generally, we do give an opinion on, of course, the financial statements and related notes, the other information, including management's discussion and analysis, the statistical section, as well as the introductory section we do not give an opinion on. On pages 3 through 11 is management's discussion and analysis. This is really the best place to find information on the what happened during the year in the city as far as the financial statements and financial position, and also some information on the plans and the budget for next year. Management's done a very thorough job in the MD&A section. The analyzed financial position as well as budget to actual performance. And they also do a good job of addressing the stewardship of taxpayer dollars.
Do we want to say, you have those financial highlights and it might be worth talking about fund balance and net assets or...
Yes.
And the draw on the budget.
Yes, I was actually going to point those out as I walked through through the statements. On pages 12 and 13 are the government-wide statement of net assets. At the bottom of page 12, you can see the total assets for the city at year-end were almost $775 million. Approximately 88% of that amount is invested in capital assets. Cash and investments total...
Okay, say that again. What?
88% of that, of the total assets, are really in capital assets.
Okay.
Cash and investments totaled $58.2 million at year-end, which is consistent with prior year. On page 13, total net assets were almost $556 million at year-end. This is an increase of $7.6 million that we'll see when we get to the statement of activities. There are certain net assets that are restricted. You can see those listed sort of in the middle of the page. CDBG funds are restricted for federal program use. And then drug fund and hotel motel funds are restricted by state law. Water and sewer funds are restricted as those relate to tap and access fees. On page 14 is the statement of activities, which really explains the changes in net assets for the year. If you look, sort of concentrate on the bottom of the page, five lines up from the bottom is that change in net asset line item. Again, the total is about approximately $7.7 million. Out of that, the governmental activities is $5.6 million increase for the year. This was due primarily to stronger tax and fee collections in 2011. Of course, as we've already discussed, sales taxes were up, facility taxes also increased, along with road impact fees. Overall, the total general revenues this year were up $7.2 million. So all that sign, all that is a positive sign of some economic growth that's happening within the city. Under the business type activity column, net assets have increased $2 million. This was primarily due to the increases in water and sewer rates that went into effect during January 2011. Total water and sewer charges were up about 19%, whereas water and sewer expenses were up about 9.6%. So the difference is what caused that $2 million increase in net assets. About three lines up from the bottom, you will see a prior period adjustment of $1.9 million. This relates to the city's net pension asset. The city makes contributions to its pension fund, and on a cumulative basis, if those contributions are over or under what is determined by the actuary, that over or under is recorded as an asset or liability in the statements. And so as of 2010 and 2011, the city had contributed more than it was required to by those actuarial valuations. So that amount should have been recorded as an asset in 2010, which is the prior period adjustment, and then it's also recorded in 2011, it's about $2 million.
So you said it should have been recorded, was it recorded? I mean...
No.
We're saying it wasn't.
It was not recorded as an asset prior to, right. On page 15 is the balance sheet for the governmental funds. At the bottom of the page, this is where you'll see the new reporting requirements under GASB 54. Under fund balances, there are the five categories of fund balance that are now required under that statement. Non-spendable fund balances are really your non-monetary assets. In this case, all of that's inventory related. Restricted fund balances are those that are restricted by law or regulations. Committed are those that are committed by board action. Assigned can be assigned by management. And then unassigned are all other fund balances, or any negative fund balances also have to be reported as unassigned. There were two funds with negative balances at the end of the year, the road impact fee fund as well as the facility tax fund.
Which facility, what are you talking about?
Facilities tax.
General facilities tax.
They're getting, as of our report, they're getting close to, they're getting close to even again.
On page 26 is the conclusion of the budget and actual comparison for the general fund. You can see that the original budget called for a $669,000 reduction in fund balance. This was primarily for capital expenditures. Budget amendments increased that anticipated draw up to nearly $2 million. These budget amendments were due primarily to carryovers from the prior year budget. As of the prior year end, there were certain paving activities as well as some police cars that had not been delivered yet. So those budget amendments were made to allow those to come into 2011. The actual decrease in fund balance was $952,000. There were some positive variances against budget. General cost containment as well as positive revenue variances caused an overall positive variance for the general fund.
So from a budgetary standpoint, we could have drawn almost $2 million. We drew less than $1 million due to some offsets and revenue coming in a little better and underspending through various departments and items such as that. So really generally a good outcome for us from a expenditure standpoint. And controls, the departments really did a great job of minding and managing their budgets throughout another challenging year. So this shows that.
Skipping ahead to page 52, within the notes to the financial statements, I will point out some of the notes that changed, some of the significant notes to the financials. This note, again, addresses the requirements of GASB 54. Not only does GASB want you to show the five categories, but the disclosure of the reasons for the restrictions or commitments is also required. So management put this schedule together to show the total fund balances by category and then the reasons for those restrictions, whether they're restricted or by board action, by state law, federal law, et cetera.
And the stability funds are what you were telling me, that's our...
That's our reserve.
Our reserve.
We call it our reserve policy.
Right, and then even further detail of those stability funds is there at the bottom of the page.
So this is...
So really and truly, my question was, is that just based on our policy, or do we actually need that for, saying cash flow, but really,
well, we went through the process with the PFM folks,
right,
to talk about, based on our size, our expenditure patterns, how much do we really need for emergencies, contingencies, seasonality of our cash flows, etc. And these are the numbers we came up with, and we defined them as a percentage of the budget. We did a really good job doing that. What's left to do now is to set a policy of how we're going to use those funds, if we ever have to. And if we have, and if we do use them, how are we going to replace them? How quickly?
That's true.
So that's the next step.
The next step in your policy development.
But we were saying any funds that were above, that would be above 33%, though, right?
Would be unassigned.
Yeah.
However, you know, so that last policy thing that we got from, this will be something for us to talk about again, because that last thing that we, when we finally got the norms for the AAA cities, they had 40%, I believe, didn't they?
Yeah.
So we need to, well, that'll be another day to talk about.
That's one element, but also taking the policy to the point of clearly defining when you draw on it, how you replenish it. And it clearly provides a roadmap for how you handle that is really, really the next generation for us in terms of developing that policy too. So that's something we'll be looking at going forward.
Is that something that can help us with?
They can, yeah, certainly.
And look at some best practices with that, how to do that.
PFM, for the financial consultants that we've hired the last 2 years now?
Mm-hmm. They've been coming up on three. They joined right around when I came on.
Already? Oh my gosh. Okay. That's right.
Time flies.
Continuing on, pages 54 through 57 are the pension and OPEB note disclosures.
Go ahead and describe what OPEB.
Yeah.
OPEB is other post-employment benefits.
Where's that?
That's on page 58, starting on 57.
Starting on 57?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what is it again?
Post-employment benefits is the caption there.
So these are beyond, this isn't pension, but it's other obligations like the health insurance.
Health insurance.
Obligations we have to the folks. We may have folks that are eligible to retire, but are not eligible for the federal Medicare yet. So we provide an option to provide medical insurance in that bridge period. And so this is a summary, essentially, of those obligations.
Right. The GFOA had several comments on last year's CAFR requesting some additional information in these two notes. And so we analyzed that, and we added several charts to both notes. If you were to put last year's CAFR and this year's CAFR together, you'll see this year's disclosure has been expanded to address those requests from GFOA. Specifically, on pages 55 and 56, bottom of page 55, that chart, and then on the top of page 56, these charts really address the funded status of the plan. And the similar charts to that on the other post-employment benefit plan are on pages 57 and 58. Really, at the bottom of page 56, the last line item there, you can see the net pension asset at the end of the year. That's where that $2,086,000 comes in that's now being recorded in the financial statements.
And where the $2 million came from, it came from the additional contribution we did in 2010, so that's where that $2 million is coming from.
Skipping to page 85, this is the schedule of expenditures of federal awards. The city spent $4,845,000 in federal program dollars for fiscal 2011. This compares with about $3.7 million for 2010. So there was a significant increase in federal award activity for the year. We have audited seven major programs in accordance with A133. This compares in prior years to generally two or three major programs. Those major programs totaled approximately $4 million, so we've audited about 85% of the total programs of the city this year. You can see those major programs are noted with that footnote, the star. Starting on page 87 is the statistical section, and what I found particularly interesting about the statistical section for the city is really paints a picture of how much the city's grown in the last 10 years. You can look at things like net assets have increased $195 million over the past 10 years.
What did you say? Oh, I see. Writing some notes and I lost your page.
Yeah, if you look at page 88, if you compare the $359 million to the $554 over a 10-year period, it's grown about $195 million. And then similarly on page 89, if you look at total revenues, it's increased about 74%. Population in the city has increased nearly 50% over that 10-year period. On page 94 is a new chart this year relating to sales tax revenues. Of course, sales taxes are the city's largest single revenue source. So this chart was added to really show the trends in sales taxes over the last 10 years.
Up and down, and maybe back up again.
Yeah. Hopefully the positive trend will continue.
Right. And that share of general fund revenue is interesting. We stay right in that mid-40 range, 40% of our revenue. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a lot of good information in the statistical section.
And now, whenever we're talking about the general fund revenue, we've taken out the amount of the property tax that's going for debt service, right? Or is that still included in the general fund revenue?
The property tax is out in the last 2 years.
2 years, mm-hmm. Yeah. So that makes this kind of interesting, I think.
So, yeah, if you factor that in, it might bring that number down a little bit.
Bring it much down much less, okay.
On pages 109 through 112 are two other independent auditors' reports that we issue in conjunction with the audit. The first is our consideration of the city's compliance with laws and regulations, as well as internal control over financial reporting. Yeah, it's in the internal control and compliance section.
I don't think it has a page number.
It's right after 108.
Right after 108. That's page 108, but I don't think the others have the numbers.
Right after that.
They don't have the numbers.
There's no number on the opinion page.
On our letterhead, it'll be on that.
Yeah, our letterhead will be on that.
On that page, it will have our letterhead.
Right.
And we don't usually put a number on it, we have letterheads. We can.
Just we need to be able to find it.
So this report, again, describes our consideration of the city's compliance with laws and regulations and internal control over financial reporting. There are two findings referenced in this report that we will get to in a minute. The second report describes our testing of the city's compliance with its federal grant programs. Again, we audited seven major programs under A133 requirements. We have drafted an unqualified opinion on compliance. The city did comply in all material respects with its grant programs. The report, again, does reference one finding. Those findings are on, start on page 114.
I noticed on 113 it says oddity qualified as low risk, and the answer was no. So what does that mean?
Well, yes, that has something to do with it.
If you have a finding.
What your findings say.
If you have findings as well.
Gotcha.
And really, it wouldn't have mattered this year. The difference between low risk and high risk is low risk, you get to audit up to over 25% of federal awards. High risk, you have to audit over 50%. And in this case, we audited 80, so.
It's really a little different than you normally think of low risk and high risk. It's just a federal requirement to determine what you audit.
Again, the findings start on page 114. We did have three findings. Two are related to the financial statements. One is related to grant programs. We are required to bring these to your attention as part of our audit. Just to provide some context before I get into the details, the items are certainly important, but for lack of a better term, they're nothing to lose sleep over. They are important to note and follow up on, but we don't believe there's any long-term or systemic issues, certainly no gaping holes in internal control or anything that would require significant, you know, attention toward accounting or internal control systems. The first item relates to the pension assets. As we described with the prior period adjustment, that net pension asset should be recorded within the financial statements. We're recommending that the city record that pension asset based on the actuarial valuation each year. Management concurs and has already implemented procedures, already asked the actuary to provide some additional information, some information in a different way to make that reporting easier. The second item relates to street acceptances. During our testing of infrastructure assets, we selected several street additions. Upon further investigation, management determined that the streets had not yet been formally accepted, as the bond sureties had not been released on those streets, and so they couldn't be formally accepted as assets of the city as of year end.
Well, I have a question on that, though, because I generally think we release those bonds right away, don't we? I mean, I don't think the Planning Commission does it anymore, but we have those things that the engineering goes through, so.
You mean they're released?
The bonds are released whenever, and so then the streets become ours.
After review, yeah.
As soon as they're accepted, right?
And
accepted?
So then it's released? But they're saying apparently here we have.
We hadn't completed that process.
Had not completed that bond.
It's a timing and communication issue in that, you know, the street department recognizes streets sometimes before they've actually been released and accepted.
Okay, so really it's the difference between the streets.
It's a cutoff.
Streets just doesn't.
It's a cutoff. We cut off, excuse me, June 30th. So they were probably accepted in July or August.
Yes.
When it's very desirable, we actually release the bonds, because they're the ones that did that now, right?
Yes.
It's not the Planning Commission anymore. But still, they would have to be hours, though, before the streets do anything to them, don't they? Okay.
Then on page 115 is the third finding, which relates to the grant programs. During our grant program testing, we noted that certain expenditures had been coded to a particular grant as part of the year-end estimation process, and it was subsequently determined that those expenditures should not have been coded to that particular grant. So an audit adjustment was made to decrease the grant receivable and also decrease the schedule of federal expenditures. It's important to note that the amounts that were incorrectly coded to that grant had not been requested yet from any federal agency, and so there's no liability issues or no differences or problems created there.
So I don't think I get this one. So you're saying that the grant, we actually coded some expenditures that were not allowable to the grant?
There were some expenditures that were coded, yes, to that grant on the city's internal records. And then
city's
it was subsequent.
Expenditures?
Yes.
Okay.
And then it was subsequently determined, yes, that those should not have been coded to that particular grant. And so that the grant expenditures were reduced and the schedule of federal expenditures were reduced.
And so was that corrected?
It was corrected.
It was, okay.
And we're never submitted for reimbursement.
It was
or
never
grant draw.
Submitted for
it never got to that point.
Yeah.
But
yeah, right.
Okay, good.
So, management's implemented procedures to address that item as well as the other two. So, we don't think that we'll see these repeated in the future.
When we made this estimate, we were thinking these were grant-eligible expenditures. They were coded to a generic code. And in 2012, what we're doing is we're actually asking the department to code those that are eligible to one code and expenditures that are actually not eligible to a different code.
Okay. Keep it straight. Move on to the conference center now?
Yes, I'll switch to the conference center, and again, I'll go through the required communications book first. Yeah, we'll go through this a little quicker.
Yes.
Again, page one is just an intro letter. Again, management of the conference center provided full cooperation, were very helpful during the audit process. On page two, we have drafted an unqualified opinion on the conference center's financial statements, and we are independent with respect to the conference center. At the bottom of page three, the significant accounting estimates include the useful lives of capital assets. Capital assets on the conference center's financial statements are about 97% of total assets. So obviously the useful lives of capital assets is a pretty significant assumption. And then the appropriateness of the assumptions used and calculations made to allocate expenses. That's probably the biggest risk in the conference center's financial statements is the allocation of joint expenses between the hotel and the conference center. Certain there's a lot of admin and other types of expenses that are incurred jointly, and then there's an allocation process by agreement that allocates them to the hotel and to the conference center.
A certain percentage of that.
Yes.
Or how do they do that? Is that just, I don't know how that's done.
It's specified by formula in the contract, the management contract that was initiated.
What they're allowed to?
98, yes.
To use for the conference center, what they have to use for the
yes.
Well, they're
hotel?
Shared facilities.
Right.
So they have to be divided up, and it's based on a couple of formulas.
Uses mainly?
Use, volumes, dollar volumes of revenue. Mm-hmm. We can let you look at the contract if you want.
Mm, I'm just curious. Okay.
At the top of page four, there was one journal entry that was recorded to record depreciation expense for the year, $506,000. That's a pretty routine entry at the conference center each year. There were no unrecorded journal entries. Again, we reviewed the significant accounting policies, noting that they're appropriate under generally accepted accounting principles. On page five, we had no disagreements with management, encountered no significant difficulties, and also identified no fraudulent or illegal activities in the audit. Yes. Areas of audit emphasis, again, capital assets is a big area. Under operating revenues, we did make a specific selection of conferences that occurred during the year and tested that the revenue was recorded correctly.
And you found it to be?
Yes. And then again, under other operating expenses, we tested that allocation of the expenses. And then in looking at their financial statements, really, if you turn to pages 10 and 11, it really tells the story for the year.
We had a better year this year.
Yes, on page...
The year before, the last 2 years, actually.
Yes, on page 10, you can see that, you know, conference center events were up significantly this year, leading to a 17% increase in revenue. Cost containment measures, again, kept expenses to only a 9.5% increase, which led to an overall net income from operations of $150,000.
You said what, 9.5% increase?
In operating expenses.
Operating expenses. And then what else did you say?
The 17% increase in revenues.
But the insurance went down.
Yeah, we can look at that. We can look at their insurance policies.
And that's a big decrease.
See why that is.
That was rebid last year.
Okay.
That was part of what we did.
Is it?
Drop your quick.
Did what?
Rebid.
Refurbished that over here. When was that, 2 years ago? No?
Started about three and then finished up about 2 years, a year and a half, 2 years.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think, and then we did say something about rebidding. Is that safest for everybody?
But the previous year was one of very few years when they've had a loss.
That's correct.
Almost all the years they've had income to share.
Yeah, that's right, we spent the money.
Look at the cancellation income.
Yes, yeah, so the conference center was able to make distributions to the city and Williamson County of $405,000 this year, which is $202,000. To each owner. On page 11, at the very top, cash flows from operating activities. You can see very significant operating activity cash flow this year, almost $703,000. This is really what made it possible to make those operating distributions to the city and to the county. That's really the conference center financials. Are there any questions on those?
We didn't have this in front ahead of time, but I don't think there is. Somebody has something.
What's our remaining debt?
Yeah. I was going to say,
aren't we done with that 2000?
You know, I don't remember exactly what the principal is. It happens to be in this audit.
Okay. but
we have a payment next month. And then in December of 12, and then it'll be retired.
Oh, 12.
There's two more.
Well, that was 13.
Well, it's fiscal 13.
Fiscal 13.
Midway through.
Yeah.
I believe that's right.
Uh-huh.
Very good.
So that will free up somewhere in the $500,000
range.
That'll
help. I think we keep up activity. That'll be helpful too.
Well, thank you very much for these. Presentations. And if we have some questions on the audit of just the city, we'll probably decide that and handle it in January, maybe there. Okay, thank you.
We'd be glad to come back, and we appreciate you selecting us very much.
Yes,
thank you. This was
enjoyed working very much with Russ and with Mike and with others.
We have very good people to work with, don't we?
You sure do.
Yes.
Well, thanks for all the explanations in here and everything, too. That's very helpful.
Now that we've got them, we can look at.
It's Cliff Notes for 111 pages.
That's right, that's about right. I kind of scroll through them, you know, and I'm like, oh. Okay, so.
She does a scroll.
Okay, so then our business would be that we acknowledge receipt and pass it on to the board.
The full board for acceptance, is that the right term, or?
Acceptance.
Yes.
Acceptance.
You just acknowledge acceptance.
Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
Yes.
I move that.
You move, so move, you said? A second.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, so now we're back to number nine. Utility billing and policy changes.
Mr. Sims up to follow up on a couple of issues in the utility billing realm. Steve, you want to take it away?
Thank you. Thank you. In your packet, you have a transmittal memo that talks about what our issues are with accepting credit cards. Our customers are telling us that they clearly want to be able to accept credit cards. The fundamental question is going to be is how are we going to accommodate the fees that the processing companies, the merchants, that are going to build into this. Those fees will run anywhere from about 2 to 5% of the dollars that are funded through that. If you've had your own business, and had accepted cards, you understand that that's just a real cost of doing business, no different than any other goods or services that you're providing with that. And I've given you a little bit of an explanation of what is going on with those fees and in terms of why the fees vary so much, what's embedded in that, and what's ahead of us as we move into that path. And why we're doing this is that we accept cards now for many of our businesses. In terms of the utility bills, we get about 800 payments a month that come in online for people paying on with credit cards. Property taxes, we allow online payments using credit cards, but we only have about 100 a year that actually pay, again, because of the provisions, and the fees are paid by those individuals. However, in court, we accept credit cards, both face-to-face, and in those cases, we absorb that cost as part of our operating cost because we have a court fee that we apply in that. There's a $76 court fee. So, and last year we paid out about something on the short side of $5,000 for court fees. I mean for credit card fees, and that's on people that are paying it on using credit cards. But out of that, there's $150,000 where people paid. What we're seeing is once we put this in place with court, is that we actually saw a significant reduction in bad checks. We stopped seeing that. But the most important thing is we saw an uptick in people paying us right then. They didn't walk out the door and saying, I'll pay you next week. And that's a good thing because in court, while you've got them there, you want them to be able to, you know, and the judge has said, you know, well, you'll do this, that, and the other and pay the fees, is that we've got them, so what we want to be able to do is allow them to pay and not have to come back and do that at a later point. Because even though, you know, we say come prepared to pay, that doesn't always happen. So then we also allow people to call in and make payments on the court. And in that particular case, is that we got something in excess of $100,000 where people paid in it, called in, and paid their court fees and fines online. So out of all the payments that we got, a third of the payments last year were actually made with credit cards. That's a pretty good number in the court side. And so we've gotten, we had just really good success with that particular effort. We'd like to extend that to other parts of the the business endeavors throughout the city. But what we need to do is think about how we want to accommodate those fees. One of the ways that we can do that is that using just what we do with property tax. And that means is that you come into the office, you're going to pay a convenience fee. You pay it online, I mean, because it's, if not, we would have to supplement that with people who are not paying with credit cards. We'd have to do that. The other one is that where you build that into your rate, and that's the court model, where you build it into your, what you're doing.
You've got that as your court cost.
Yes, ma'am. And you can do those for things like utility bills. Utility bills, and whether or not we do that or not, of course, that's up to y'all, but you could build that into it as just part of your operating business. We get 85%+. Yes, ma'am.
I want to ask you, now when you said build that in, do you mean for the credit card payers only? Because 5% on a utility bill would be pretty expensive.
It would be quite a bit if it were that amount. But those fees, notice I said there were 2 to 5%, and it would vary significantly based on the way it's presented, what instrument is made, whether it's debit cards or credit cards, what kind of card, PIN versus signature. So all of those, you can get quite a bit of variability on what those fees are actually going to end up being at the end of the month when you settle up with the card issuer.
Okay, but that fee, that add-on would only be to the people who pay with that method. It wouldn't just be an add-on to everybody.
No.
Well, it would be absorbed as part of your operating costs. A good example is this. Right now, we end up paying to make a deposit. Just to make a deposit to the bank, we pay money to do that. We pay based on the checks, and there's a fee and all of this. So there's a yes, ma'am. And
so everybody
to deposit money, you
yes,
have
ma'am.
To pay.
Yeah. Okay.
We end up paying those. And so what we've done is that part of the operating budget of revenue management and finance is those finance costs associated with the bank is going to charge for us to be able to conduct business. And y'all approved a contract on that in order to be able to do that. But all that's built into the fees. A lockbox service. We have, like I said, about 85% of our customers pay, and we're able to process those payments electronically right now. But part of that is online payments. Is one of them. As I said, there's 800 payments a month. We get 4,000 drafts a month. That's our low cost option. If customers pay, if they decide to have it drafted, that's where we reach into their bank account and actually pull the money out based on their authorization.
And
yes, ma'am.
And are we charging them a fee for that?
No.
Because that's the cheapest for us, right?
Because the thing is, I wanted, for myself, let's just take an example here. I'm going to pay my sewer bill. I'm going to get online, go to the city site, punch it in, put my routing number, my bank number, and have it drawn out. That's what I do with a lot of my bills. Or I have it done that, but I didn't want an automatic draft every month because I did that one time, didn't like how it worked because bank screwed it up, got it messed up, and we had to sort all that out. So I'd rather just go online and pay, but you can't do that.
Well, and that option is actually used, and we get about a couple thousand.
But the other way works well, generally.
Yeah.
You may have had a bad experience.
Yeah, automatic bank draft is good. So you're saying to me that if they do an automatic bank draft, then they're not charged extra for that?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
They're also not charged extra if they walk in and pay by cash.
Exactly.
They're not charged extra if they come in and pay, if they mail their payment in or they push it online with what you do right now. We actually pick up an electronic file using your method where you push the money into into us.
Right.
However, we do pay financial transaction fees
on
all of those transactions. Because the Pinnacle is going to charge us in order to do these things for us. So we're absorbing the fees. The other thing is that we're picking up, we have staff for online, for face-to-face in the office payment. That's your most expensive option.
Yeah, because of the staff. So what you're saying is that people can have an automatic draft, but they, I'm not sure I understood you. You really can't do the push, like where I push the money into.
We're doing it now.
The best.
Yes, ma'am. 20% of our payments are made in, on utility bills are received that way. So the people who go online.
Oh, the push versus the pull.
We do pulls and pushes.
And but what is being charged for?
We are paying for all of those fees right now.
But the customer's not.
We're absorbing those fees.
The customer's paying it. The customer does pay those fees because they pay them in the utility rates that we charge.
Yeah.
So they're paying.
They are charged to everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
So before you get too deep in the weeds, what we need now is direction, because automatic payments, be they drafts or credit cards or soon to be PayPal and Google and who knows what, are becoming more and more prevalent. Mm-hmm. It's going to be an increasing part of our business. We need to incorporate that into our new utility billing. We need to know what we should charge the customer for and what we shouldn't charge the customer for. And we think it probably ought to be done by line of business, because you probably don't want the Marriott Hotel to be able to get air miles at our expense for paying their property tax. You know, when the state first allowed us to take credit cards, there was actually a law against us eating the cost of credit cards, because essentially you have to raise the same amount of tax, and people who have big credit lines would be getting a benefit, and you're basically pushing that cost off on grandma that lives on Main Street who can't use a credit card or whatever. You basically have to make it up somewhere. So anything that was a tax was more or less excluded. That law's been removed from the books, and a lot of cities do go ahead and take credit cards, but they take it only up to a certain amount. In other words, if someone had a $300,000 property tax bill, we wouldn't want to take the credit card for that. But maybe if it was the average bill, which is $200, then we might be willing to take the card for that. The more cards that we take, the lower the fees are going to be, because there's a return on volume. I mean, there's a scale involved in this too. So basically, other than court, we've taken the position that the customer ought to eat the charge if it has to do with credit or online payments. We're now questioning that model. Do we really want to continue that? Because there really is a cost to taking cash face-to-face or processing the check. There's a cost involved with everything, but it's nowhere near. You're talking about a nickel on a bank draft as opposed to maybe $2.75 for the same bill if you did it on with a credit card. So there's a significant difference there. But we need you to think about whether you're willing.
Which ones, where the nickel are and where the $2.75.
But make no mistake, if we decide to eat the cost, then what that means is we're going to have to raise the permit fees or... You know, it's been suggested, raise the yard permits, the yard sale permits.
How much?
Just tell people it's $8 and there's no fee attached instead of $5. That's, and then they've got to pay a $3 convenience charge.
Yeah.
It's pretty aggravating.
It might be cheaper it might be easier, but it also might be cheaper.
The reality is our citizens look at us a lot like they look at Target or Land's End or eBay or whoever else they're doing business with, and they expect us to work sort of the same way. And those entities all build those costs into their cost structures as well.
Sure.
So, I really think that we look at being more like that and how we structure how we do business with our citizen customers as well. Just because more and more they're going to look for us to be the same kind of transaction they deal with everybody else with.
Well, and I think it needs to be consistent across the board.
Yeah.
You know, you can't have one set of rules here and change it here.
Well, but the money is so different. Like on the $5.
This threshold issue could be a really different thing for us to look at.
The property tax versus your every month utility plus somebody that's buying a yard sale fee. Because didn't they say in here that on some of them, you have, there's a certain minimum fee?
Some are a minimum charge, yeah.
Yeah.
So percentage-wise, that could get pretty large on small transactions.
What we're wanting to do is build a model that'll say that if you, in this kind of business, is that the fees would be done this way. If you're in this kind of business, the fees would be done that way. Online payments, I would still advocate that unless there's a desired business behavior that you want to attain, and Russ hit an excellent one right there. Yard sales are ones that we do allow people to obtain permits online. Now, I don't understand loading up the kids and the dog and the SUV coming into town to get a permit, but some people seem to enjoy that. Now, I would personally, that's not something I would like to do. I would pay the $3 to keep from doing that.
And so it's an extra thing. But some people like to do it online.
Yes, but you'll spend more than that gas and time.
I don't even know why we do that. I'm sorry.
But we have a
different story.
That's a different one.
The permit for is not just to get the money.
You can do that. You can follow that model for many of the licenses types of things. Alarm permits, any kinds of, you know, plumber's license, any of these kinds of things can easily be built into that. But when you get into some things like, do we want a $100,000 water tap fee or $1 million water tap fee to be pulled on a credit card? Yeah. People have black cards that will end up being able, they don't have a cap. There's no limits. You just walk in and they can put anything. What kind of card? You know, MasterCard, Visa, Discover, Amex, and if you've been in your own business, you know that each one of those have different sets of fees that they charge, credits and debits and all of that. So what we're proposing and looking at that schedule is that you can come up with a, you know, there is an easy button on this thing. The easy button is, and everybody always looks for the easy button. The easy button is we absorb it in the office and they absorb it, you know, if it's online. But that's really, it's not an easy answer. It's, I don't think, personally, to be able to get to that kind of.
You mean each individual time they absorb it?
No, you're saying it doesn't matter.
We just eat all the costs.
Eat all the costs, yeah.
But then we have to get it somewhere else.
That's the Walmart. But we're not Walmart.
That's a misnomer because we're not going to eat the cost. We're going to find it somewhere else. We're going to.
And many of what you really want to do is, in order to do it properly, you got to look at the fees you charge and what's the real cost of delivering those as to whether or not that credit card fee should be part of that fee. In the yard sales, we may find out that, you know, it takes 5 minutes to process one. And if you start doing the math, is that in order to do it, we do it for $4 right now. I don't know what it is, but you see what I'm saying. If you really look at it, we charge $200 for this permit. Well, we may find out that we're doing it for, you know, $210, and we really need to have a $215 fee in order to do, you know, to cover all that. But those are the kinds of things you have to go through. You don't want
and
that.
And so, I need a
flow chart.
Maybe we do need to know.
To give you that, one of the things is, this is a 15-page document. And it's 15 pages, 16 pages long, and it's a line item of all the things that we accept money for.
Okay.
And in order to go through exactly what you're talking about, is there is a flow chart that says that we've got to go through and look at every one of these to see, yes, we will accept it on this, we will not accept it on that, and come up with that recommendation. So what we're looking at today is that, does this tack look right? And that is that we would look at a different set of fee structures based on the type of service that was being delivered and move along that path, and being with the idea of, after discussion with department managers and looking at what costs
to deliver that is, could we come up with a recommendation on that?
Are you going to include the amounts of the bills?
Setting a cap?
Yeah, setting a cap, or?
That would be part of the discussion.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So in other words, if we just say the recommendation is that you go with 6 and 7 right now and then come back?
Yes, ma'am. And that's what the recommendation is that we would move along that path.
What's the thought of the...
We've also asked departments to look at their own needs, transaction needs, and work with Steve on some of those issues as well, in terms of what do they need, where would it help them from a convenience process standpoint, working with citizens. So that will get factored into the case-by-case review as well.
So do we want to have this represented to Finance Committee before we go to board?
Yeah, I think
so. I think we come back to you with some strategies on how we'd handle it.
Yeah. Okay.
And, yes.
Yes.
So then, would our motion be?
To?
6 and 7 and come back to the Finance Committee?
Yes, when it's completed. Yeah. So moved.
Second.
Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Oppose no.
The other subject is bad debt. Bad debts, Franklin, we're very fortunate in that we really don't have many bad debts. We have a few in the water side, but as I pointed out in the package, is that we only had about $77,000 in bad debts that were turned over last year to be pursued by the collection agent. We've got a remedial process through notices and termination of service that lead up to that. And so we've really got that covered to a great degree. But and if you look at it, that $77,000 was out of almost $28 million that was billed. Yeah. So that's really a very, very small number. And we had almost no commercial accounts. So we've got an effort to do that. But as we look out and other things that we have, court is one of the things that we look at in terms of how we set this up. And as we look at our utility billing software that we're going forward with, one of the things that we do is have an interface with that collection agent in order to be able to exchange data. How to, you know, these accounts need to be done, and all that's done electronically. But we want to expand that to include all of our items that we choose to turn over to a collection agent. You wouldn't turn over things like property tax. We go through the clerk and master in order to go through those. There's an accepted process that can end up leading to sale of property if a person chooses not to pay. But for those things like water bills, court fees, certain permits, licenses, and I say certain permits and licenses, we really got that pretty much nipped because we revoke their license and they're, you know, and can shut them down. But you do get some bad checks periodically, not many. But in court, when you look at what we had there, is that the attachments go through the utility side, but the third attachment talks about the court. And if you look at it, we've got $650,000 in outstanding obligations to the court. That may seem like a lot, but when you talk to other cities, you hear numbers in the millions of dollars in cities that are not our size, not nearly as big as us.
These are even like parking tickets too, though, aren't they?
Yes, ma'am. And part of that package, if you look at what it says, is it was $450,000 back in the middle of the decade when I came on in the city. So it's only grown a couple hundred thousand dollars since then. And it's because, again, people pay, we allow credit card, we allow these kinds of things to happen. But that doesn't mean that there's not money out there to that we could recoup through this. So this is to really to, you know, inform you of what we're moving toward, and that is to be able to issue an RFP for a collections firm to pursue those obligations which we turn over to the agent to collect, which would be your primarily water bills or utility bills, court fees and fines, some bad checks. There might be a few little licenses, but really not much of that.
So how much are, I mean, I said a traffic ticket, I mean, a parking ticket. You know, I mean...
$10.
I know that. I mean, obviously, we're not going to spend a lot of money.
I back in backwards.
Yes,
the judge is not going to order a bench warrant for not paying a parking ticket.
That's right, not paying a parking ticket.
But how much do we lose by engaging that collection agency? Usually, the structure's like close to half.
Depending on the way the structures are, but there are firms out there that will do that on a retainer. The state has actually changed some of the provisions for collection. It'll be a lot more than $11 that the person will end up paying the collection agent. Significantly more.
But here's the thing, though. If only a couple of hundred thousand of this is over for the, how many years? So all this other 450,000 is years old? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, you've got people on the books that are deceased and incarcerated.
I know. I think we ought to think about that. I mean, if these are years and years old, that's...
You need to provide some kind of method to clean them up and follow through on them in some way. This is one way to do it. You know, otherwise, I don't know how we get closure on those.
Most cities do not get closure on them. Let's just say that that's the way it is. I mean, really.
It's a good business practice to have some avenue.
Well, I understand that, but years old...
I do think it's more about looking forward than looking back.
Yes.
I think we're going to find that most of what's behind us is truly behind us. Yeah. It's non-collectible or to the greatest extent. But to have a process in place, you know, we have a process that we exhaust now, and once it's exhausted, it lays fallow perhaps for years. You know, if you can immediately hand it off and go through a process, decide whether it's collectible or not, and then remove it, that really is a better business practice than what we have now.
What we have is that we really cannot use, there's the state, like I said, is they made some changes in the law to allow municipalities to pursue these outstanding obligations using collections agents. But they said that we're going to put certain restrictions on how you do that. You have to go through a competitive bid contract with certain limits on fees that can be done. And so part of this was to say we really need to do that, to have a competitive bid product contract to pursue these. We're dealing under some very old provisions to do the collections that we have now, and that there are a lot of firms that are out there that are having quite a bit of success in some of these endeavors. But the big thing is, as we said, as we start looking forward, we've had a very good history, but that's not to say that we won't have that tomorrow. And if someone chooses not to pay you, what recourse do you have? You know, the recourse is to use the city attorney. Well, do we want to really tie up the city attorney? I think not. That's not the best way to pursue that.
Let me ask you this. You know, whenever you were mentioning that the court costs are $76, is that for, like, moving violations?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so if you just don't pay a parking ticket, what do you have to pay except... It's $10 the first time.
It's $11, $26, and $52.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If it gets up to be a significant amount, then we will engage other actions to...
These are multiple offenders.
I mean, yes,
I, ma'am. No, an individual with multiple tickets.
Yes, ma'am.
Is what you're saying.
Can they be arrested for that? I mean, they can't they?
Well, that's kind of different from somebody that just comes in and backs into the parking place, especially whenever we didn't have those big signs that says backing in, you know, you must be head-in parking.
You're not going to go out and get somebody for a $11 ticket, but, you know, what if somebody has, there was somebody in town here that, didn't they pay up a couple of years ago, and they had like a couple hundred dollar, you know, $500 fee or something?
There's some recourse that we have that we look at individual cases to see how much more to invest on behalf of the city to pursue those obligations.
I mean, do we actually have any outstanding high dollar amounts here right now?
What's high dollar?
Well, you know.
$100.
Yeah, well, $200, $300, $400.
Yes.
We do.
Well, I mean, how many?
Do they still live here?
In parking tickets?
How many of those are there? How many of those are there?
Not many.
Well, I mean, we could, hey, we could have this legal department do them.
Send the alderman out for it.
We do.
Garnishment.
That's what we do now.
What's been the method of trying to collect these old debts? I mean.
From court. The state.
Say like 5 years ago, there was something. What have you done in that span of 5 years to continually knock on that door?
There is some potential that they will visit us again. And if they visit us again, we blow the dust off of it and bring that to their attention.
Yeah. I guess my thing is if we do start pursuing this old debt, I think there's got to be a cap of like, okay, if it's been X amount of time and we haven't done our due diligence of saying annually or biannually, hey, you owe us this money, hey, you owe us this money, to all of a sudden 5 or 6 years later go, hey, guess what? We found this file and you owe us this money plus this much for every year. And yeah. I don't think it's fair. That's why I'm saying I don't know the practices we've done in engaging ourselves with them on a consistent basis to say, hey, we need to get this taken care of. I wouldn't, like, if I screwed up and didn't pay something and 5 years later it's like, you've got a parking ticket and it was in 2003 and since it's 2011, guess what? We need a second mortgage on your house to get this ticket.
Yeah.
I would be really upset. Yeah. Be like, oh, really? All of a sudden now, 8 years later, you're coming back to me? I don't think that's, I just want to make sure that we've done the right thing to set ourselves up to go back and collect.
That's a good question. Do we do that? I mean, how often do we tell
and I'm not accusing you. I'm sorry. No. We just met. But,
that's a good
you know.
Question. That's a good question, though. How often do we pursue that?
The process is that if you do not show up in court, is that on your appointed court date, is that we will send you what's known as a failure to appear notice.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That in that adds additional cost to the process.
Like how much?
Another, it's 20? You're subject to a $50 fine and $76 in court costs.
Oh, so your $11 ticket is now
No. The
these are some moving violations.
We do not do that for parking tickets. These are traffic violations.
Traffic.
Parking tickets are really not much. And as you can see from the chart, they're nearly not much there. The moving violations is that
they don't have your chart.
We don't have a chart.
Yeah.
Oh, that wasn't.
No.
Oh, that's right. I'm sorry.
That's right.
What happens is that the failure to appear is issued. That's issued to them by certified letter. That's another $5 in costs that we incur in order to do that, and that and so that's sent out to them in a registered mail to be able to. So they have to sign for it. Mm-hmm. If they don't, and many don't. Then what we do is at that point we notify the state to have their license suspended. And so we've notified the state, and again, I think that's one of the reasons why we are seeing, we don't see much increase now, because a lot of people end up, the state will then notify them that their license is suspended. And so at that point, then it will lay there. We do not check back with these on a recurring basis to remind them that they have an outstanding obligation.
Yeah, once they get the letter.
They've lost their license, though, right? They've lost their license, though?
They potentially have lost their, they have had their license suspended. They're driving on a suspended driver's license, potentially. Yes, ma'am.
Which can also be another fee.
Out of that $650,000 that's out there. A lot, that's what those people, that's the...
The bulk of it
is
due to traffic violations.
So they're driving on a suspended license?
They're potentially driving on a suspended license. It's whether or not the state got... it depends on whether the state got it processed.
They do, though.
I love that.
Are they?
Yeah, they...
I mean, are they, do they follow up?
They do. Yes, they do.
Yes, ma'am.
Steve, you mentioned a while ago that sometimes people will return for services. But are you talking about licenses for those or permits?
No, they have another violation. They got stopped for speeding or traffic.
Yeah, that's right.
And so they visit the court.
That's right.
And we remind them of an outstanding obligation.
Right. Yeah.
I say go get the $650,000.
Well, but I mean, we're talking about $400,000 of this is years old.
Yeah, I know. That's true.
So, you know.
Probably have to.
Well, part of the reason we bring it to, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
No, do we ever do anything like the library, like, hey, you know, come in and pay it and you just pay your fee and get it over with?
Oh, I know. Do we put boots on cars for parking dollars?
No.
No.
No, we do not. HOAs do though.
They do?
Well, but
let me remind you that many of our people
Lenient stage?
That come here, yeah, that is a thought, are tourists. And they're visiting our city.
But one of the things we've done is we've instituted a warning process on parking.
Good.
You get two warnings before you get a ticket.
Okay.
So that should take care of our visitors. And if you're a visitor and you're creating a major traffic violation, you should get a ticket.
Yeah, sure.
But on the parking side, we have provided some grace on that, recognizing that we have a lot of visitors and there are times that folks may not always understand all the special considerations. So we've provided a little bit of extra forgiveness on that. So really, you don't get a ticket till your third violation now.
Good.
On parking.
It's pretty lenient.
It is, but hey, my husband paid somebody's ticket after they complained, so not even somebody he knew, but a friend of a friend. He just said, hey, I'm just paying the tickets, forget the rest of it. He didn't want us to have a bad reputation.
I would just love to see, I guess, the chart that we're missing, which is maybe the breakdown in age and where it came from.
Age of the ticket.
Sorry, not like how old the offender was. I mean, how old the debt is.
I was going to say, we probably need to.
There's about 7,000 tickets, if I'm not mistaken. They're outstanding. The software has certain limitations relative to doing a receivables aging.
Okay.
We can provide you with.
Because really, we're talking about the bad debts. We're really talking about the court cases, right? Is that it?
Yes,
I mean, because on the other things, we're handling them.
And yes, ma'am.
Okay. Well, maybe we need to see the breakdown and think more about this now that we know more about it. Is that?
We're not trying to make your life difficult.
No, but this, yeah. It's got to be reality's got to get into
I'm also concerned if we turn this over to collection agency.
We don't want the repo man.
Of course, their actions are going to reflect on the city.
That's right.
No matter how they conduct themselves. So I think we need to look at the risk of that, too.
I think we're all, but you're saying across the board that you don't want anyone to ever be pursued by a collection agency.
No, I'm not saying that. No.
I think our concern is more of the old debt, or mine is. I'm sorry. I'm speaking for everyone.
No, but I think
and
that.
And what the amount is, maybe.
Yeah, and the amount.
I'll see what I can.
And but I do think we just have to have a leg breaker so you're not having to be the bad guy. I mean, for you to be the one.
They've got enough to do here. They don't need to be out chasing people.
Exactly.
And that's really a lot of the position we've taken is that we will give people adequate opportunity to settle up, and if they don't, then our action primarily on traffic violations is to notify the state to have their license suspended, and at that point, then we there's a lot of bad things that can happen if their license gets
So our
court system is not open, our city court. If somebody runs a parking ticket that say runs over $200 or something, we still just turn that over to the state?
No, we're saying that We look at individual situations, right.
Okay.
We pursue individuals once they get over a couple of $100.
Okay.
And those are pursued with the city attorney. And that's where we work with orders, court orders. If we have to go across the street, we do. If we, in order to, I know it's hard to imagine, but people run up $2,000 parking.
Really? In Franklin?
Yes, sir. And so, but those are rare, and we work with them to make sure the city, the other people in the city who are doing things right are, you know.
Get a fair place at that parking spot, right?
City attorney has to go to county court to.
We may file papers to be able to pursue if.
If they don't pay up.
People don't meet their obligations.
Okay. Well, get us the chart for next time, and we'll think about it some more on this. Is that what we're thinking on the bad debts? Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
I'll have you on the chart.
Yeah. So we can look at them. And the last part is just the monthly reports for information only. I guess since we've been here almost 2 hours, I guess we'll just look at these on your own. Some things I'd, you know, like to know about, but not what we're talking about.
If you have questions about any of the reports, please contact us. We're happy to answer. I want to compliment Mike. He's redesigned the quarterly report. It's a little tighter and easier to read. If you have any comments about that, please let us know.
I mean, it's worth looking at.
For the listening audience, it's posted on the website, so it's available.
Thank you. Okay, so then we'll hear a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye. There we go. Thank you.